New York. This is Democracy Now.
The Afghan people would like to know, you know, where this road now leads, because people are thirsty for a political settlement. People are thirsty for peace.
In this special broadcast, we look at the crisis in Afghanistan with Bilal Sarwary, an Afghan journalist who is based in Kabul, reported on Afghanistan for 20 years before he fled with his family after the Taliban seized power. Plus, we speak to Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter Spencer Ackerman about how the U.S. could have ended the war two decades ago when the Taliban offered to surrender and hand over Osama bin Laden.
It was the Bush administration, the United States, that said such a deal was unacceptable, not to the Afghans, but unacceptable to the United States, that now took it on itself, as it has so often throughout its history in so many parts of the world, to tell Afghans the way their country was about to be.
We'll speak to Spencer Ackerman about his new book, Reign of Terror, how the 9/11 era destabilized America and produced Trump. All that and more coming up. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Today in this special broadcast, we begin with the longtime Afghan journalist Bilal Sarwary. We spoke to Bilal first on August 18th, 3 days after the Taliban seized control of Afghanistan, after the U.S.-backed Afghan President Ashraf Ghani fled the country. I began by asking Bilal about whether he was surprised the Taliban seized power before U.S. troops withdrew from Afghanistan.
Actually, I was trying to get a marriage certificate for me and my wife, and we were trying to get a passport for a newly born daughter. So I had spoken to government officials the day before. Some of them were my friends. The next morning, I was heading towards those offices when I heard that the presidential palace employees were told to leave. And the Presidential Protection Service, which is Afghanistan's equivalent of Secret Service at the time, were taking up positions. So there was a lot of confusion. And then in a matter of basically 30 minutes or so, we found out that the then President Ashraf Ghani was supposed to go to the Ministry of Defense to have a meeting at the National Command Center, which is a walking distance or a short drive. But instead, Mr. Ghani had told his Secret Service detail that he would want to fly there. So the Minister of Defense was waiting. The Army Chief of Staff was waiting. The helicopters changed directions, and they were heading towards the Hamid Karzai International Airport. I think once that fact was revealed, the entire government in Kabul crumbled in no time, just like it had crumbled across many of Afghanistan's provinces, where mass surrenders were negotiated between important provincial officials and the Taliban. I think it's a Taliban strategy, as well as fighting on the battlefield over the last many months at least, that they offered this insurance, that they offered this surrender deal. And I think this was the work of months, if not years. So it was surreal in many ways, because I had started my career in 2001 when the Americans were bombing the Taliban. I was a fixer translator across from the Pakistani city of Peshawar. And then I saw the fall of Taliban. And it was unbelievable to see how the tables turned, how there was panic and fear. My family this time was here. This time I was, I am a father to a new baby girl. And I was not exempted from the panic and fear. Will there be fighting? Will there be bloodshed? What will the Taliban do? But thanks God, Kabul fell to the Taliban without bloodshed, without fighting, although the vacuum created did result in some looting and some harassment and irregularities of the citizens of Afghanistan. So I would say, for me, it was almost like, in no time this happened. I just couldn't believe it, like many other Afghans.
Bilal, as we begin to wrap up, you wrote a piece for The Telegraph. You said It's broken me from within. Afghan journalist reveals heavy toll of covering his country's collapse. That was the header. You write, I became a father recently because my own family and relatives saw so much heartbreak these past few years. I prayed that if God gave me a baby girl, I would name her Sola, which means peace. I did that thinking that at least my daughter might grow up in a normal country. So you are trying to leave right now. How do you go about that? Have you thought about staying? Do you think you could possibly be safe in Kabul, in Afghanistan?
Well, my, you know, like honest opinion here is that I would love to tell the story of the people of Afghanistan. I think everything that has happened, including the loss of friends, both within the government, outside of the government, and, you know, I have friendships within the Taliban. I have a classmate from my days in Peshawar as a refugee, and we went different ways, has left me thinking, what is it that I can do that will comfort me, you know, that would make me think that I'm doing something better? And over the years, I've been having this conversation with myself, and then I committed myself to telling the story of this country to the world, not only the news side of it. I created a hashtag Afghanistan University many years ago, and where I basically showed the world the other side, the beautiful valleys, you know, the natural beauty, the lakes, you know, what Afghanistan could potentially offer in the future if tourism was to come back here. And to be honest with you, I would love to be here like the rest of my colleagues and be able to tell the world our stories, because 20 years ago, this country did not have this generation of reporters. And we owe this in large parts to our international colleagues, where we started working as fixers and translators 20 years ago. And they helped us get where we are. So I think it's very important for the world as well to have a credible and vibrant Afghan media where different voices can be heard, because we live in a world where we are interconnected. You know, there's no more any country in the rest of the world that will not matter for anyone else. You know, humanity is something that gives me hope. You know, people care these days about any country and anyone, especially like when you look at the activists on social media and such platforms. So I hope that I'm able, you know, and I hope that my daughter is able to basically one day go to school here. But there are things that are beyond my control. There are things that, you know, people like myself and my colleagues and other Afghans simply are powerless. We can't do that. I hope that this generation of leaders, both the Taliban and the former officials and politicians, can leave a legacy where we walk away from our painful historical political past, where governments came with coups and tanks and with bullets. And for this, I think the people of Afghanistan over the last 20 years have paid like a massive price, you know, a lot of sacrifices. I will not go into the mistakes, into the failures, into the issue of corruption. I think I would let history judge that. But the people in this country, you know, the lives, when I look back, you know, there was a river of blood, like literally flowing. People gave their lives in districts for education, for health, you know, ordinary people. A tribal elder in Paktika, like, dedicated his own land, making sure that his daughter could go to school like the rest of his district, you know. I think those are the type of things that I hope one day will give us peace, you know, that has remained extremely elusive in our lives and the lives of generations in this country.
Afghan journalist Bilal Sarwary, speaking on August 18th, just 3 days after the Taliban seized control of Afghanistan. At the time, Bilal was hoping to stay in his country. But just days later, he and his family boarded a flight to Doha, Qatar. He posted a message on Twitter reading, "The day I leave my country, my city, my Kabul, a massacre of my dreams and aspirations, a tragic day in my life," he wrote. On August 25th, a week after our first conversation, Bilal joined us again, this time from Doha. I asked him to talk about his decision to leave Afghanistan.
Extremely painful decision. All of a sudden, I had to leave my office, which was next door to my home, without being able to tell my sisters or family members where we were going. I took my parents, my wife, my baby daughter with me, We were hiding for a couple of nights, and then we headed towards the Hamid Karzai International Airport. And since I know this city so well, it's my hometown, it's my city, it's where I grew up, I felt like nowhere was safe for me. As Taliban fighters and certain members of Taliban factions continued to knock on doors. I don't know why they were doing that, what exactly they wanted, and why did the Taliban political leadership fail to prevent such searches, which are widespread across many different parts of the city. The only thing that I could really leave with was a pair of clothes. And only 2 weeks ago, I had gone to the northern parts of Kabul city, speaking to people who were forced because of the war in Kunduz province and elsewhere in northern Afghanistan. And that at that moment that I was talking to them, I immediately went back to the 1990s when I was a kid and we were forced to leave Kabul because of the fighting. And I would never and ever thought that only 2 weeks later on, it will be my fate as well. So the fact that I could only pick up my own computer and a couple of iPhones and chargers and a pair of clothes and not knowing actually if we will make it into the airport and outside of Afghanistan was, I think, a very, very painful period of time, especially for my family's sake, for my daughter's sake. But once I was on the plane, thanks to the Qatari government for evacuating close to 150 people alone on that flight, I could see everything that Afghanistan was over the last 20 years. I saw the country's most popular TV presenter. I saw the most famous woman who started every morning on Tullo's most popular show, Bamdadi Sob. And my wife recognized her. I could not immediately because she was covering her face. And, you talked about burials of dreams as we spend, the next 12 hours all together. A lot of these are people that I know. There's an artist. His name is Sharifi. He was known as the Art Lord. He was painting a lot of these, peaceful messages, anti-corruption messages on these blast walls on the streets of Kabul. He was there. And no matter what I did, to not think about it, I thought, well, this is the tsunami, of brain drains. This is Afghanistan going down the drain in a matter of seconds. And some people were crying, some were quiet, others just simply did not want to talk. And that literally summed it up for me. When I first arrived at the military airport, I think it really had a very, very negative impact on me because it was that location that over the years I traveled to across the country with senior Afghan military officials covering their operations. And coming back to it, knowing that nothing exists anymore in Afghanistan's institutions, Afghanistan's national security forces, Afghanistan's air force, all crumbled, I think also hit me very hard.
Bilal, in your article for the BBC, you write about the fall of the Taliban after the U.S. invasion in the fall of 2001. You say, "I saw a genuine willingness amongst the rank and file of the Taliban to lay down their arms and resume their lives. But the Americans didn't want that. From my reporting, it seemed to me and many other Afghans that their motivation was revenge after 9/11. We're coming up on the 20th anniversary of the 9/11 attacks. Can you talk about the peace moments lost when you actually had the Secretary of Defense under Bush, Rumsfeld, saying no to the Taliban, saying they would surrender if Mullah Mohammed Omar could remain living in dignity in Kandahar, and even the Taliban saying they would turn over before this Osama bin Laden?
I think in hindsight, when the Taliban government was toppled by the Americans at that time, their fighters and most of their mid-level commanders did go back, to rural Afghanistan. They wanted to start their normal lives. There were raids, they were jailed, they were, killed, mostly, at the hands of warlords who were allies back then with the Americans, and there was a lot of family politics, tribal and clan rivalries. People wanted to settle old score, or people simply wanted to lie to the Americans so that they can get something back in return. And those mistakes would cost Afghanistan immensely. But it's also true that the Americans shut down the door on negotiations very earlier on, refusing President Karzai's request that such negotiations and back-channel talks must continue. We know that there were a lot of letters and communications at the highest echelons of the Taliban leadership with the former Afghan President Hamid Karzai and other elements of the government at that time. Obviously, the other mistake was also the fact that the leadership went back to Pakistan, where they got help from the Pakistani intelligence services and the Pakistani army, institutional support, something that has been well documented. And on the ground, the Afghan government literally failed to curb corruption, injustice, provide basic services. You know, the Afghan government was seen as a milking cow, you know, among these various powerful figures where government positions were handed over as trophies. So I think when you think about that and the U.S. decision at the time to invade Iraq, the hijacking of resources, I think all of those mistakes, all of those, you know, policies at the time contributed towards, you know, the bigger problem. And I would also say that the Taliban over the years had this feeling, this very prevalent feeling among their leaders and commanders that they can win militarily. When they found out that the Americans were withdrawing, the announcement in the absence of a peace process or a comprehensive ceasefire, it was just a matter of time before the Taliban would take over. But no one thought this quick. And I also think that a 9/11 style commission report must be launched to find out what led to the crumbling of state institutions in Afghanistan, to the billions of dollars worth of sensitive military equipment that the Taliban now control. Because after all, this is taxpayers' money from many of these countries invested. And I would also cite a personal example where I lived in a very central part of Kabul. My next door neighbor appeared as a neighbor. We had a good relationship with them. We were on friendly terms. After the fall of Kabul, it was very clear to us that that was the Taliban's intelligence operations. In a street that was home to special forces commanders, former interior minister, the head of the defense committee at the Afghan parliament, and a number of intelligence chiefs across many provinces. So you are also talking about a massive intelligence failure that should go back to a few years when Taliban were able to, for example, recruit university students who had a job at the central part of Kabul in a bank. I knew a guard and I knew a bank employee over the years. I would go and talk to them. And the fact that the Taliban were able to recruit, you know, right into the heart of the Afghan capital, right under the eyes of the Afghan intelligence service, I think also shows you that this is a massive process of failures, the responsibility of which, you know, is with the Afghan government, with the Afghan institutions and leadership. And how could have they, like, failed, you know, the people of Afghanistan on so many levels?
Afghan journalist Bilal Sarwary, speaking from Doha after fleeing from Kabul, Afghanistan. To see our full interview with Bilal, go to democracynow.org. When we come back, the Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Spencer Ackerman, author of Reign of Terror, How the 9/11 Era Destabilized America and Produced Trump.
To me. Oh, I despise answer to me.
War by Edwin Starr. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We turn now to look at the roots of what's become America's longest war. The U.S. invaded Afghanistan October 7, 2001, less than a month after the al-Qaeda attacks on the World Trade Center and the Pentagon. Within days of the U.S. bombing of Afghanistan, the Taliban offered to hand over Osama bin Laden, the al-Qaeda leader. But the Bush administration rejected any negotiations with the Taliban. This is Bush's press secretary, Ari Fleischer, responding to a question in October 2001.
Would you go so far as to say that no matter what the Taliban might say at this point, it may not make any difference? Are you ignoring whatever they may say?
The president could not have made it any clearer 2 weeks ago when he said that there will be no discussions and no negotiations. So what they say is not as important as what they do. And it's time for them to act. It's been time for them to act.
In December of 2001, just a month or two later, the Taliban offered to surrender control of Kandahar if its leader, Mullah Mohammed Omar, would be allowed to, quote, live in dignity in opposition custody. U.S. Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld rejected the offer.
If you're asking, would an arrangement with Omar where he could, quote, live in dignity in the Kandahar area or some place in Afghanistan be consistent with what I have said? The answer is no, it would not be consistent with what I have said.
That's Donald Rumsfeld speaking December 6, 2001. The U.S. war in Afghanistan would continue for almost 20 more years through to now. According to the Cost of War Project, the U.S. has spent over $2.2 trillion in Afghanistan and Pakistan. By one count, at least 71,000 Afghan and Pakistani civilians have died in the fighting. Afghanistan is now facing a massive humanitarian crisis, and the Taliban is back in power. Well, today we're spending the hour with the Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter Spencer Ackerman, author of the new book, Reign of Terror, How the 9/11 Era Destabilized America and Produced Trump. The book is based in part on his reporting from Afghanistan, Iraq, and Guantanamo. Talk about this moment as the U.S. began bombing and occupying Afghanistan, when the Taliban basically said they would surrender and also give Osama bin Laden over. The U.S. rejected. President Bush rejected both.
This was a central aspect of the war on terror at its inception and a foreshadowing of what its implications would be. Once we accept the frame that Bush offered, war on terror, we were then locked into a struggle not just against al-Qaeda, the entity culpable for the 9/11 attacks, but a much broader struggle against an enemy that a president could redefine at will and leave in the popular imagination was something along the lines of a civilizational challenge to America for the future, one in which America itself was in the balance. Now, let's look in particular at that moment in Kandahar. The United States' Northern Alliance allies had routed the Taliban from Kabul. The Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan had fallen after about 5-6 years in power. And they recognized, after a last stand they tried to put on in Kandahar didn't go the way they expected, that the end was near for them. And then they offered to Hamid Karzai, the U.S.'s appointed leader for a post-Taliban Afghanistan, that as long as Mullah Omar could live in some kind of house arrest, basically, you know, not be killed, not be, you know, put up on trial, they were prepared to entertain negotiations for what their role might be in a post-Taliban Afghanistan, basically a political settlement at that point. Karzai, for all his flaws that the United States would both contribute to and then criticize him for over the coming years, nevertheless knew Afghan history and recognized that unless there was some kind of political future for the Taliban. The Taliban would opt for a violent future, and they had a proven capacity not just to wage an insurgency, but to triumph in one. And Karzai took the deal. It was the Bush administration, the United States, that said such a deal was unacceptable, not to the Afghans, but unacceptable to the United States, that now took it on itself, as it has so often throughout its history in so many parts of the world, to tell Afghans the way their country was about to be. And everything that happened since, the 20 years of war since, has contributed on, if not quite a straight line, a kind of, you know, nausea-inducing glide path to the abject horror we're seeing at the Kabul airport, with people desperate to flee, so desperate as to grab onto C-17 cargo planes and fall to their deaths. This is not the alternative to fighting in Afghanistan. This is the results of fighting in Afghanistan.
So if you could take it back even farther to the U.S.-backed Mujahideen, to the U.S.-backed mm-hmm. Osama bin Laden, and talk about what happened when the U.S. decided to fund the Mujahideen in fighting against the Soviet occupation of Afghanistan, and then the Mujahideen setting literally their gun sights, their U.S. weapons, on the United States, and how the Taliban came out of that.
Yeah, it's important because, like, an objection to this is always going to be that we, you know, portrayed, like, the, you know, 1980s Afghan Mujahideen as the Taliban. They weren't the Taliban. They were the precursors of the Taliban. What happened in the 1980s is the Soviet Union invaded Afghanistan, and the United States saw an opportunity. It saw an opportunity to inflict upon the Soviet Union, its great geopolitical adversary, a defeat as humiliating and as psychologically devastating as the one the United States suffered in Vietnam for its own imperial hubris. Over the course of the next 10 years, the United States, the Pakistani ISI, and the Saudi intelligence services funded and equipped Islamic extremists, rebels who would come in from Pakistan, among them a figure who would become intimately familiar as a Taliban ally, Gulbuddin Hekmatyar, a particularly brutal person. And over the course of the 1980s, they inflicted tremendous damage on the Soviets, made the occupation, which was a brutal occupation by the Soviet Union, ever more violent and ever more protracted, to the point where the Soviets withdrew, and a couple years later, the regime the Soviets installed collapsed, much as like we're seeing the one that the United States installed collapsed. The ensuing chaos and civil war was devastating for Afghanistan. Out of the ashes emerged the Taliban, an extreme group, a group that, you know, used mechanisms of extreme suffering and repression on the long-suffering Afghan people, and something that the United States never recognized throughout this entire period was that it had destabilized Afghanistan not simply as a pawn of, not simply as a consequence of fighting the Soviet Union, but that was what the cost of fighting the Soviet Union was, that an entire country, millions of people, suffered tremendously, that they were treated as tools by the United States, that their aspirations, their desires for freedom, their desires for security ultimately didn't matter to the United States, much as they didn't matter to the Soviet Union. And in the chaos that resulted, the Taliban took power. They sheltered Osama bin Laden, but they weren't the same thing as al-Qaeda. And the United States, after 9/11, decided that there was no relevant distinction between al-Qaeda, between the Taliban, and between what it called terrorist groups of global reach, which ultimately washes out to saying that while the respectable version of the Bush administration's policies were already an extremely expansive conception of who could be targeted, moving from terror groups like al-Qaeda, to ultimately entire regimes. The Deputy Defense Secretary Paul Wolfowitz spoke in the immediate aftermath of 9/11 about ending states. But in the broader political, journalistic, and then popular conception, the enemy could be all of Islam, or it could be something just short of all of Islam. And from there, it was an extremely short, rather immediate transition to fearing American Muslims, fearing your neighbors, thinking your neighbors posed a threat to you, not that this apparatus of war and repression posed a threat to you.
You know, Spencer, one of the things that hasn't gotten reported very much is that as the Taliban seized control in these last weeks of Afghanistan, a key person that they executed, he was imprisoned and they executed him, was Abu Omar Khorasani, the former head of the Islamic State in South Asia. The significance of this.
Yeah, this is an extreme complication that has come up in the last couple years of particularly U.S. Taliban negotiations, by which I mostly mean back-channel negotiations. I shouldn't say back-channel, to be a little bit more specific. They weren't authorized before they were authorized. It was somewhat of a freelance effort by a retired U.S. Army colonel named Chris Kalenda and a retired U.S. ambassador to Pakistan named Robin Rafel. What they discovered in their talks with Taliban figures in Doha was that the Taliban were rather concerned about the rising presence of a so-called Islamic State branch in Afghanistan, what called itself, or the U.S. also called it, ISIS Khorasan or IS Khorasan. Essentially, the Taliban feared a kind of next generation of extremist entity insurgency using Islamic justification inside Afghanistan. And with somewhat, I think it's fair to say, good reason, given the way that ISIS fought and displaced al-Qaeda, the organization and entity that it emerged out of as well.
And again, they killed him. They executed him, took him out of a prison in Kabul on that final day, Sunday, as they took control of the country. Spencer Ackerman, talk about the role the U.S. war and occupation, the brutality of the U.S. airstrikes, the torture at Bagram, the night raids played in gaining new recruits for the Taliban.
The United States tends not to attribute its brutality to any of the circumstances that it comes to bemoan when they manifest in the world. And Afghanistan is certainly a tragic example of that. The fact that after 9/11, the United States, in its political and journalistic and intellectual elites, generally speaking, refused to accept that there was a direct and tragic and awful historic consequence of its destabilization of Afghanistan in the 1980s to the degree that Taliban facilitation of Osama bin Laden in the country helped the execution of the 9/11 plot, which it's important to note did not involve Afghans and was not staged from Afghanistan, nor was it even planned in Afghanistan. It was far more planned in Germany. Nevertheless, that was an early foreboding of what we would see over the next 20 years, not just in Afghanistan, but throughout the war on terror, a disconnection, an unwillingness to face that America's violent and imperial actions breed their own next generation of enemies. That was on display once the United States went back into Afghanistan. And throughout the Afghanistan war, even during periods where counterinsurgency campaigns, at least on paper, paid lip service to the idea that protecting Afghan lives and, property and so forth was going to ultimately be decisive in the war. It never acted that way. It never acted as if what the point of the war was the protection of Afghan lives. It more often acted in such a way that it did not draw distinctions between Afghan lives and Afghan enemies. And amongst the major reasons for this is not necessarily like a specific decision to target Afghan civilians, but an inability to understand the country, understand its dynamics, and understand the rather complicated relationships in many ways between people who fight for the Taliban and the Taliban itself, or people who aid the Taliban under threat to their own life or threat to their family, or simply seek to endure the war, as so many people throughout so many wars simply aspire to, simply by not taking action that harmed the Taliban because they understood the consequences that could that they could experience. Over time, all of these things strengthened the Taliban, made the Taliban seem like, once again, a viable alternative to the United States. And then on a different level, the United States' contribution, and not just the United States alone's contribution to the misery in Afghanistan, came through the corruption that it always blamed on the Afghans, but was a significant driver of itself. So-called development experts, development aid and development money poured into Afghanistan far beyond a consideration of what a devastated Afghan economy could in fact absorb. And some of this money was very deliberately flooded in from the CIA to pay off warlords to ensure that they would ultimately be responsive to American interests, which would often be violent interests, which would often be things like, as the Joint Special Operations Command would perform throughout the Afghanistan war, Army Special Forces in particular throughout the Afghanistan war, raids on people's houses suspected of being aiding or facilitating the Taliban. And again, the Taliban, not even al-Qaeda, not the thing that attacked the United States, certainly not the core of al-Qaeda that plotted, planned, and executed 9/11. The United States was now at an extended war with a one-time harborer ally of al-Qaeda, rather than the thing itself, responsible for all of Afghanistan, but never acting responsibly toward the Afghan people.
I want to go to January 2015. This is the Obama years. Two hostages, one American, one Italian man, were accidentally killed by a U.S. drone strike along the Afghan-Pakistani border. Here's then-President Obama later apologizing for the killings.
This morning, I want to express our grief and condolences to the families of two hostages. One American, Dr. Warren Weinstein, and an Italian, Giovanni Laporto, who were tragically killed in a U.S. counterterrorism operation. Since 9/11, our counterterrorism efforts have prevented terrorist attacks and saved innocent lives, both here in America and around the world. And that determination to protect innocent life only makes the loss of these two men especially painful for all of us.
So there you have President Obama apologizing. Spencer, you have spent a good amount of time in Afghanistan. You were embedded there, and then you also reported independently there. Can you talk about the significance of this moment?
This was a profound moment. This is the only time that the United States, particularly the president of the United States, has not only acknowledged drone strikes that killed civilians, but apologized for it. And the reason why it's such a significant moment in its singularity is both in the book and for an earlier series that I did for The Guardian in 2016, I interviewed people, Pakistanis and Yemenis principally, who were survivors of drone strikes or whose relatives were killed in drone strikes. And one of the stories I tell in Reign of Terror is from a young Pakistani man named Fahim Qureshi. Fahim Qureshi was 13 years old when Obama launched his first drone strike, and it blew up Fahim's compound where he lived with his family. And they were gathering for a celebration of one of his relatives who had just returned from a successful business trip to the United Arab Emirates. 40 days later, Fahim woke from his coma. He had burns over most of his body. He was missing an eye, and he had learned that most of his family's breadwinners had been killed in the strike, so that when he left the hospital, his responsibilities would immediately be providing for his family, however it was that his mangled body would perform. And I talked to him about the difficulties he experienced throughout about 7 years. And among the things he discussed was that he had tried through Pakistani authorities and through the U.S. embassy to get some kind of acknowledgement that what had happened to him had in fact happened, and that it didn't just happen as an act of God. It happened as an act by the United States of America. And none of that ever came. What did come was a supply of blood money, essentially, a payoff, essentially to say, like, okay, this is what will count for restitution, and your account is settled, and you're not going to get any public acknowledgement, let alone an apology. And I kept hearing when I interviewed people, not just Fahim, but other people whose lives were changed irrevocably by drone strikes, about how Obama had apologized when he had killed white people, and never when he had killed people like them, never when he had killed their loved ones, never when the consequences of his actions had left someone maimed, had left someone in a position where he had to give up his dream of being a chemist and work however he could, in the hope that, as he had put it to me, some of his younger cousins and his brothers would be able to live happy and prosperous lives. And I asked him, what do you think of Barack Obama? And he said, if there's a list of tyrants somewhere, Barack Obama's name is on it because of his drone strikes.
Spencer Ackerman, we're going to break and then come back. Spencer is author of Reign of Terror, How the 9/11 Era Destabilized America and Produced Trump. He's a national security reporter who publishes the Forever Wars newsletter. Generals and Majors by XTC. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We're spending the hour with Spencer Ackerman, the Pulitzer Prize-winning national security reporter, author of Reign of Terror, How the 9/11 Era Destabilized America and Produced Trump. Spencer, you begin your book with the prologue with Timothy McVeigh visiting the far-right paramilitary compound in Elohim City, Oklahoma, before what you call the prologue's chapter heading, the worst terrorist attack in American history. Talk about the connection you see between the rise of right-wing extremism in the United States and the so-called war on terror.
I thought it was extremely important to see the war on terror in its fullness, in its totality, and only then can we understand its implications. And I think the only way to really do that is to look at who were the exceptions to the war on terror, who the war on terror didn't target, despite fundamentally similar actions. And there we can understand not just what the war on terror is, but its relationship to American history, which shapes it so deeply. And so I also wanted to kind of start with a journalistic cliche where the reporter kind of zoologically takes a reader through this unfamiliar and scary world of violence committed by fanatical people who are training with heavy weapons and talk about committing mass atrocity for a sick and supposedly divinely inspired religion. But I wanted those people to be white. I wanted the reader to see how similar these actions were, how similar some of the motivations were, how similar some of the justifications were. But we never treated them like that. The whole purpose of the phrase war on terror was a kind of social compromise amongst respectable elites in order to not say the thing that they were, in fact, building, which was an expansive war only against some people's kinds of terror, only against non-white people's kinds of terror, only against foreigners' kinds of terror, and not against the kind of terrorism that is the oldest, most resilient, most violent, and most historically rooted in American history, one that seeks to draw its own heritage out of the general American national heritage. People who call themselves not dissenters, not rebels, but patriots, people who are restoring something about America that they believe a corrupt elite that is now responsive to non-white power at the expense of the extant racial caste that has been deeply woven inside not just the American political structure, but the American economy that drives American politics, how that ultimately never gets treated. This is exactly what Timothy McVeigh was about. This is what Timothy McVeigh had as his motivations for murdering 168 Americans in Oklahoma City, including 19 children. And we looked away from it. We looked away from how deep the rootedness of white supremacist violence was in this country. We listened to what I believe are principled civil libertarian objections against an expansive category of criminalized association, treating people who might have believed, as McVeigh did, odiously, as I believe that is, but ultimately not committing acts of violence, treating them as essentially indistinct from McVeigh was absolutely intolerable, as it always should have been, to the American political elites. But that intolerability did not extend to Muslims. And there it was easy after 9/11 to construct an apparatus fueled by things like the Patriot Act that expanded enormous categories of criminal association known as material support for terrorism, authorized widespread surveillance that certainly would not be focused simply even on American Muslims, as disgusting as it was that it was focused on them primarily. But ultimately, all of these things that both parties, that the leaders of the security services and intellectuals created, maintained, and justified so readily against the threat of a foreign menace seen as civilizational, seen as an acceptable substitute for a geopolitical enemy that had served as a rallying purpose throughout the 20th century. The war on terror is kind of a zombie anti-communism in a lot of its political caste and association. And never would any of this be visited upon white people. From the start, the war on terror showed you exactly who it was going to leave out from its carceral, from its surveillance, and from its violent gaze.
So I want to go to Donald Trump this week, considering a 2024 challenge to President Biden. Said in a statement, Biden surrendered to the Taliban. Meanwhile, Republicans on the House Armed Services Committee demanded a plan from Biden to stop Afghanistan from becoming a, quote, safe haven for terror groups after the Taliban takeover. This is Republican Congressman Michael McCaul on CNN.
We are going to go back, Jake, to a pre-9/11 state, mm-hmm. a breeding ground for terrorism. And, you know, I hate to say this. I hope we don't have to go back there, but it will be a threat to the homeland
so
in a matter of time.
You have the Republicans now talking about a foreign terrorist threat. The Republicans who have been denying the insurrection of January 6th, calling it, you know, it no worse than a group of tourists coming to Washington, D.C., and not wanting to investigate that, even though under Bush, under Trump, the intelligence agencies have said the number one domestic terror threat is right-wing white supremacists.
We see who the war on terror then is now is a mechanism for having terrorism excused not terrorism, dealt with. When that terrorism is white, when it is politically powerful, when for reasons that they themselves probably ought better to explain, politicians sympathize with it, seek to draw strength from it, that's a real serious red flag for American democracy. We don't have to treat it as if it is a new red flag for American democracy. This is always how American democracy has been eroded. This is always alongside the ways in which capital has been extremely willing to ally with white supremacy. This is what the creation of Jim Crow was. This is how the maintenance of segregation in the north of the country, which we don't often talk about as much in its different permutations. I'm a New Yorker. This city is segregated even still. You see that definitely with the way the school system is constructed. Ultimately, we are seeing throughout this past week the ease with which the Republican parties, supposedly now in the Trump era, feeling antipathy to the war on terror, readily snap to war on terror politics when it comes to the demonization of refugees. The idea that America has a responsibility to take in the refugees that it itself creates out of this psychotic racist fear of white replacement, that demographics are ultimately driving the erosion of, in its respectable settings, white political power, not just on the fringes, but at the centers of American governance. And that is a politics of the war on terror that has been here from the start. Trump makes it vastly less subtle, to the extent that it was subtle, than it was before. And his hold on the party is not an accident. His hold here has everything to do with the way that he was able to recognize the ways in which the war on terror is an excellent sorting mechanism for figuring out who is a real American and who is a conditional American. And then, as we saw him using the tools of the war on terror on the streets of cities like Portland and Washington, D.C. and New York and, in the skies over many, as many as 15 cities last summer, he's willing to use it on Americans that he calls terrorists.
Spencer Ackerman, you write repeatedly about Adam Hassoun. Tell us his story.
Amy, I just want to thank you so much for asking about Adam. I knew you would. You have truly been one of the journalistic heroes of this era. And Adam Hassoun is a symbol of the ways that the war on terror criminalized people. Adam Hassoun is a Palestinian-born man who survived. He grew up in the Lebanese Civil War of the 1980s and immigrated to Florida in the 1990s. And as a refugee himself and an active participant in his community in Miami in South Florida, in the Islamic community there, he wrote a lot of checks to refugee charities, people that he had thought were helping refugees and helping war victims in places like Bosnia, where the wars became genocidal in the Balkans against Balkan Muslims. And ultimately, among the people that he met and tried to help was a convert named Jose Padilla. Jose Padilla would, after 9/11, become famous as someone John Ashcroft accused of trying to set off a radiological weapon inside the United States. And very shortly after that happened, Padilla was at first placed in military custody, an American citizen. That was allowed at the time. The feds came for Adam. And even though Adam had committed no violence, Adam had done nothing criminal, the feds and immigration authorities locked him up and they leaned on him to try and inform on his community, to try and be an informant. And he refused to do that. He considered it an affront to his dignity. He considered it unjust. And as a result, he spent a tremendous amount of time. He spent years in jails in Florida while ultimately the FBI and the local prosecutor, who would eventually be the Trump cabinet member Alex Acosta, came up with pretexts to prosecute him. He was originally charged as a co-defendant with Jose Padilla, who is now placed in federal custody. And even though there was no way that the government could connect him to any act of violence, thanks to the Patriot Act and thanks to, frankly, the atmosphere politically in the years after 9/11, that he could be charged with things that simply, you know, were not acts of violence or acts of active contribution to specific people committing specific acts of violence that the government could name. And he was convicted. And as he was sentenced, the judge reduced his sentence. The feds were seeking life for Adam because the judge recognized that the government couldn't point to any act that he, you know, act of violence that he was responsible for. That was in 2007. He served until 2017 in federal prison, a variety of federal prisons. And then in 2017, when he had finished his sentence, he had figured that he would be deported, that ultimately he would go back to, you know, probably Lebanon. He was kind of done, as you can imagine, with the United States at that point, but he didn't. What happened instead was that he was sent into ICE detention in western New York, outside of Buffalo, at a place called Batavia. And after the Patriot Act became law in 2001, there was great civil libertarian fear over one of its provisions, Section 412. Section 412 said that any non-deportable non-citizen, which is to say a stateless person who doesn't have a country that will take that person in, who is deemed a threat to national security by the authorities, ultimately in this case the determination is made by the Secretary of Homeland Security, could be imprisoned indefinitely. That never happened throughout the whole war on terror, until it was time to keep Adam Hassoun locked up. Ultimately, in early 2020, around like late February, early March, Adam gets sick to the point where he, we don't know for sure, but he thought that he got COVID. By April of that year, Batavia was the ICE detention facility with the highest COVID outbreak inside. So here was a figure who the United States criminalized, robbed of his freedom, and then ultimately endangered his life by the incompetence and indifference that it showed in allowing COVID to run wild in facilities filled with people that the United States functionally treated as non-people. And it took a very valiant effort by local attorneys and by the American Civil Liberties Union to challenge his detention. Ultimately, instead of outright losing the case, as a judge indicated after she ruled Adam had to go free because the FBI admitted that it relied on a jail. Adam was ultimately successful once the government dropped its case in order to preserve its power to do this. And he lives in freedom, I'm happy to say, right now in Rwanda.
We have 30 seconds. What has surprised you most about what is happening today?
Very little at this point, I'm sorry to say, surprises me. But the general indifference by the American political and intellectual elites to the relationship between the war on terror and the erosion of democracy is also a very deep thread and very historically rooted, not just in the war on terror, but before. And certainly seeing that those connections have to be made in order to have any form of real democracy in this country and safety and dignity for so many people.
Spencer Ackerman, I want to thank you so much for being with us. Pulitzer Prize-winning national security reporter, his new book, Reign of Terror, How the 9/11 Era Destabilized America and Produced Trump. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks so much.